Today we're talking about Iran, a country doing so badly it might soon get its own lifetime special. Last week, the United States began to sanction Iranian oil, because apparently at some point there's even a limit to where we'll buy oil from. This is where things get weird though, in the way that leaves me again saying, how the heck did Donald Trump get it right when everyone else didn't? And I mean everyone else. Instead of a growth spurt the IMF anticipated only months ago, it now projects a recession starting in 2018, a deepening fiscal shortfall, and inflation more than tripling from last year. I mean, I haven't seen this big reversal of fortune since every Bond villain declares himself king of the world immediately before getting blown up. Just look at these graphs. The May forecasts are in black, and the updated November forecasts are in red. I mean, that's like the difference between your kid going to Yale and going to jail. What the heck happened? First,
crude oil prices keep on falling. Prices of West Texas Intermediate crude dropped for the 9th consecutive day, its longest plunge since July of 2014.
Much like a cocaine dealer in 1990, Iran is stuck with a large supply of once valuable material that now nobody wants to buy. And what they can sell has gone down in price so much. When over half of your exports are oil, you kinda hope that your resource never becomes 2000 and late. But, oh my god, Iran, are you trying to get a resource war trending? That's so Bush era. Now it's all about trade wars. If you look at what the oil prices need to be in order for Iran to break even on US sanctions, it comes to just over $100 per barrel. And oil's current price is just over $50 a barrel. Well then, you can see that Iran is currently over a barrel. One other interesting effect, interesting being the most neutral word I can use, of these sanctions is their effect on inflation.
The impact of these sanctions has already been felt in Iran since then. One of the biggest impacts has been on the Iranian currency, the rial. It actually weakened to a record low of 190,000 rials to the dollar in early October.
Iran's currency might soon be worth less than the paper it's printed on. If you look at the revised IMF inflation predictions, you'll see it's now tripled from about 10%, which is already terrible, to over 30%, which means your currency is devaluing faster than a collection of Bill Cosby antique merchandise. Ask for the real Coke, as opposed to what he handed you. Okay, that slogan did not age well. I'm surprised that it has zero bidders. So why is the currency value tied to oil in Iran? Well, it starts with,
we have some savings, and every day the value of it is going down while the dollar keeps going up. We figured we should buy some dollars now to protect our money.
When nobody values your currency, well, its value goes down. When people are dumping your currency for foreign currency, that is not a good sign. Especially when your government doesn't have enough foreign currencies to make exchanges. Because, guess what? You're not selling things to foreign countries anymore, so how are you getting foreign cash? There are other ways of getting foreign currencies, but they all require friends, a resource that Iran is low on right now. Another blow is,
being excluded from SWIFT services simply means a big financial loss for Iran, as this makes business with Iranian banks almost impossible for international clients.
SWIFT is a banking communication company. Wow, really? Combining the two most loved sectors there? Telecom and banking? Basically, it allows banks to communicate internationally and exchange currencies. And more importantly, pay for exports. Essentially, Iran is now the geopolitical equivalent to that one restaurant that's cash only. The EU pushed for SWIFT to continue including Iran, but SWIFT instead listened to Trump. So now the EU can't not sanction Iran because, oh jeez, I don't have any cash on me. Do you? Hey, I'll bring some next time. So all of these problems are stemming from the Trump sanctions? Well, remember how the IMF is recalibrating their Iran predictions? The IMF said that the contraction in the Iranian economy that it is now projecting over the next 2 years is due to reduced oil production under the sanctions. So their failing economy is all our fault. Feels good, doesn't it? This worries some people because generally when you can legitimately trace your country's major economic problems to a punishment from another country, well, that doesn't go over too well. Don't worry, though. This is Iran we're talking about. They're not known for erratic behavior.
The Trump administration believes maximum pressure and careful enforcement will force Tehran back to the table in search of a better nuclear deal. Your view?
I don't think so. I think we're going to see the reverse, that Iran is actually going to, if not accelerate its nuclear program, it's certainly going to stay entrenched.
So far, Iran has actually taken a page out of the Donald Trump playbook, specifically saying fake news and U.S. sanctions are having no effect on their economy. Although, Rouhani, what's the end game here? No, American sanctions aren't ruining our economy. It's us? If you look at their GDP, though, you'll see what he means. They were just starting to feel the benefits of sanctions relief, so this just put them back to it's not great. But it would be like threatening to return America to what our GDP was in 2016. So that feels like a victory. Yay, we economically destroyed a foreign country. Is it time to unfurl the mission accomplished banner yet? The key is to understand what America's goal is, which is a little bit more complicated than leave the Iranian economy a smoldering mess. Of course, priority number one is no nukes, because, well, we just destroyed their economy. They might be a little angry about that one. Maybe give them a 20-year cooldown period. Trump also wants Iran to abandon its ballistic missile development and to stop supporting militant groups in Syria, Yemen, and elsewhere that the United States regards as terrorist organizations. So, how do we do that? Well, how did we get to the last Iran deal?
Sanctions brought them to the table to negotiate. They did the very thing everybody put the sanctions in place to get them to do, which is negotiate.
I mean, that's pretty hard to misinterpret. I'm getting the vibe that John Kerry thinks those sanctions were a good idea. So, is destroying Iran's economy the right move? I mean, liberals, Obama did it, conservative, Trump's doing it. Both parties can join hands and sing kumbaya over the campfire that is the Iranian economy. Some are skeptical that sanctions are the only condition that brought Iran to the table. Two other reasons have been cited. First,
what Iran really wants, in part, is to continue enriching whatever you believe, but using continuing nuclear enrichment. Does this deal stop that?
Well, this deal doesn't stop it in the first step because it is just a suspension, but it does stop all of their enrichment over 5%.
Some countries fight to enrich citizens, others to enrich their uranium. In fact, previously, there were 3 years of talks that failed in 2005 as a result of U.S. insistence on preventing Iran from enrichment. Iranians want the ability to enrich uranium a suspicious amount, like the kid who really wants to learn how to start a fire. You know, maybe he's just interested in wilderness survival? The deal allowed Iran to continue enriching uranium, but no more than 3.67%. Which is enough for civilian purposes such as power plants, but is much lower than what's needed for a nuclear weapon. Now, saying you need uranium for nuclear energy is fine, but it really undermines your argument when every day you talk about how you can enrich uranium to weapons grade. What? These bullets? No, I use them as fuses. But if you cross me, I could get my hands on a gun in the next 48 hours. This allowing for the continuation of low-level uranium enrichment was a compromise that Obama made that I'm sure Trump would not be willing to. The other piece that brought Iran to the negotiating table was...
Iran has reached a historic agreement with major world powers over its nuclear program.
Last time, America and the EU were a package deal, but this time, allies sold separately. On the same day our sanctions went into place, European diplomats said European efforts to create a special purpose vehicle to process Iran's import and export payments had made some headway. They're trying to make their own Swift bank to continue doing business with Iran, like a parent slipping dinner to their grounded son. As far as the rest of the world goes, the old deal was just fine, and they're trying to prop up Iran's economy as much as possible to avoid there being a nuke in the balance. So, we're really seeing eye to back of head on that one. On the other hand, we have what Iran wants, which has been deemed unrealistic. Check this out. President Hassan Rouhani has demanded that the US sanctions be dropped, and that the U.S. return to the nuclear deal, which Iran continues to comply with. The problem for Iran in these negotiations is that it imposes no political costs on the president and little pain to the U.S. economy. So Iran, it seems as though we've stumbled into an area where we can just hurt you from the sidelines without risking anything. It's like finding the promised sugar-free cupcake that doesn't taste like sand. That is, until you get a nuclear weapon or decide to put more funds towards terrorist activities, like you did the last time we put onerous sanctions on you. Until next time, thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello YouTube, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you want to support independent, nonpartisan comedy news, remember to subscribe by clicking on this floating logo to the right of my head. Or do it the old-fashioned way by clicking the subscribe button below. Ring that bell so that freedom will continue to ring, and if you like what you saw, remember to give me a thumbs up. Lastly, as always, thank you for watching.